Jeff?
Here.
Dan?
Here.
I'm here. Mark? Sarah?
Here.
Nine present.
A quorum is present. May I have a motion for the proofs of notice to be accepted as proper notice and to proceed with the meeting?
So moved.
Second. Go.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Please join me in standing and saying the pledge of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
May I have a motion for the approval of the agenda?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.
Okay, I just want to know which one you took.
First item, public comments. Does anybody have any public comments? Item number two, update on 2018-19 district configuration transition.
And hopefully, as you were driving in tonight, you noticed that they're removing the playground equipment at River Valley Elementary School, which is the first step in getting a new playground there and also up at River Valley Early Learning Center. We don't have to remove, we're not removing every piece of equipment up in Plain, but we are here on this campus and we're waiting for the asphalt to be removed at both sites along with back here at the middle school. And then we'll put some basketball hoops in and get the asphalt back on the ground. So you should be aware that we've been in communication with St. Luke's in order to get the equipment into our playground at the Early Learning Center. We do have to go through their property, and they are unfazed by that. They're going to be redoing some blacktop on their playground as well. So, otherwise, Carla met with the busing people today. We're continuing to move forward. I'll introduce Carla in a couple minutes.
Thank you, Tom. Item number three, board reminders, announcements, and training opportunities. I would like to welcome our newest member of the administration team, Carla Peterson. She's the new principal of the River Valley Elementary School and Early Learning Center. And Tom, would you like
to? Yeah, we're really excited that Carla is elected to join us. She comes to us with 20 plus years of elementary classroom experience. We had a very robust candidate pool for that position. We had more applicants for that position than we're getting for most of our teaching positions, frankly. And we think the experiences Carla's had in the transitions that have occurred in her previous district are going to be very instrumental as we move forward. So we're excited to have her here. So welcome. Thank you.
Welcome, Carla.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
Item number four, legislative update.
A couple of things. River Valley still has not received any of the school safety grant dollars. Mr. Novak has been in communication with both CISA 10 and tried to make communication with the state as well. I think Brian has been involved in that. There doesn't seem to be a process to that process at all. So we're just not really sure. We assume that we're going to be getting between $75,000 and $100,000, but when?
They put the names in the hat and just draw them.
No, I mean, at first it was very political, you could tell, and then the larger school district, but now it doesn't really seem, I know Fred's been following it very closely, it just doesn't seem like there's
little groups, and then there's nothing, and then another little group.
And then the other piece of legislation that I want you to be aware of, I know we talked about this at a previous board meeting, but when Governor Walker elected to use his line item to change the energy exemption program and put a moratorium until 2018 in the budget last year, is still alive. And there are a group of legislators that are hosting a public hearing. It's actually called Act 59 the 16th, so next week, about that particular piece of legislation to try, from my understanding, to try to get it back into the budget within the next 2 years. So.
That doesn't do anything for us.
It's not going to help us in the next two years, but
it's trying to get it in, introduced into the budget.
Correct.
Yeah.
So I've got the little press release that just came out last week. And that's it.
All right, thank you, Tom. Action items, number one, consent agenda. Checks, invoices, receipts, June 2018. Open session meeting minutes, June 14th, 2018. I entertain a motion to accept the consent agenda.
So moved. Second, Stroll.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Item number two, consideration and action on academic standards notice. This is a required notice that needs to be approved annually, so I'm going to read it and then we can have a motion in a second. The River Valley School District follows the Common Core state standards as adopted by the State of Wisconsin Department of Public Instruction as an outline of base expectations. The related accountability and testing is conformed to as appropriate to be in compliance with all state and federal laws. Where appropriate, the classroom materials have been aligned to the CCSS. The CCSS, being only an outline of base expectations, are exceeded in almost all areas of school offerings.
Motion to
approve. Second.
Any further discussion?
I really don't know who's checking. I don't have to send anything to the state to say that we've approved this. I just think if someone were to look, the requirement is that we should have taken action sometime during the summer months on an annual basis.
So on an old-fashioned grading scale, the Common Core standards would be what, a C?
The Common Core state standards, you know, I think they're a pretty good roadmap for driving reading and math curriculum. They're really a reading and math standards that were developed over time. They've been somewhat controversial, but from real face value, I think they're fine, they're good. Our curriculum aligns, the curriculum that we've purchased in reading and math in recent years is aligned to that curriculum. And I know Mr. Cry met with the math teachers this week, and they're continuing to update their curriculum, and you're meeting with the science teacher. Met with science teachers yesterday, trying to look at our curriculum and align that to the next generation of science standards. So it's something we continue to do. But in math and reading, you're supposed to identify what standards you're using on an annual basis. What kind of review or punitive action might come if you didn't approve this? I have no idea.
So we are exceeding most of the Common Core standards and whatever we possibly can.
The state assessments are based on the Common Core state standards, and we continue to meet or exceed those.
Thank you.
So there's a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Item number three, consideration and action on academic and career planning document approval. Again, this must be approved on an annual basis, and there are no changes from the previous year.
And it was attached. It's obviously been in the news a lot. We're trying to make sure that all of our high school graduates leave school, college, and career ready. And this particular requirement is very much like approving the standards that we're utilizing. I don't really know. No one's checking. It's just a requirement that we have.
So there's not any required changes or anything like that?
No.
Motion to approve.
Thank you.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Yes. Motion carries. Item number four, consideration and action on resolution to appoint Human Growth and Development Committee for 2018-19 and 2019-20. So we just need to appoint a committee, or do we need to actually appoint the people on the committee?
I think you approve a resolution to appoint a committee.
Okay.
So it does list the people on it. So that should be included in your packet. Again, this is something that we're supposed to do every other year. We meet approximately every other year and review primarily the human sexuality portion of the human growth and development curriculum.
So I entertain a motion to act on this resolution. Accept it. Approve it.
So moved.
Second.
Oh, Jeff.
This is a roll call, so we'll take a roll. I mean, we'll take a roll call.
John?
Yes.
Kylie?
Yes.
Fred?
Yes.
Kathy?
Yes.
Jeff?
Yes.
Dan?
Yes.
I'll vote yes. Mark?
Yes.
Sarah?
Yes.
Nine yes. Motion carries. Item number five, consideration and action on annual meeting date in October 25th, 2018. So we, every year we need to set this meeting date for the annual meeting. And it is on a Thursday.
7 p.m.
It can be.
Usually it's...
Little theater. Yep. That's generally where we have it. The state has given us, July 1st, they give us a preliminary estimate of our state aid. And it's where we thought it was going to be. We don't get the final estimate until October. Beginning, and we have to approve this by the end of October. Is that correct, Mr. Cry? So that's why we some districts that have an annual meeting in the summer then have to have another action later in the school year when they finalize the budget. So we've elected probably the last 7 or 8 years to have the annual meeting in the fall after we get final numbers. And the state, our state aid looks to be about $200,000 more for our district next year compared to last year.
What was that again?
It's about $200,000 more next year, which is what we anticipated.
Right.
209 or 204.
Which doesn't affect, remember, our overall budget. That's
right.
Just,
say, yeah.
lessens the amount of taxpayers.
It's part of the graduated cylinder that comes from the state. Thank you, Mr. Butler. It was a scientific.
I was liked it.
You get to liked it.
So we need a motion to have the annual meeting on Thursday, October 25th, at a time to be announced later.
Well, we should probably put that in the motion. 7 p.m. at the 7 p.m. at the high school little theater would be what I would recommend.
Okay.
Any further discussion? Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Item number six, consideration and action on the 2018-19 handbooks. There's a list of handbooks. Elementary student, middle school student, high school student, special education, at-risk, athletic code, activities code, coaches, all staff employee handbook, and crisis plan.
Motion to approve the 2018-19 handbooks as presented.
Not all of them are included. We've hired a new at-risk teacher at the high school and are transitioning someone that requested a transfer from the high school to the...
Did someone second that?
No. Yeah.
I'll second it.
Thank you. I just want you to be aware that we want the staff that we've hired to take a look. I know James and Lisa have had some conversation. But we want the new staff persons that we've hired to help frame that for next year. So it's not included in the package right now.
So if there are changes, then we would need to approve that document?
At a later date, correct.
So then, okay, so then we just have the elementary, special education, and middle school.
And all the athletic and activities are the same as last year.
So high school as well.
And the high school. The only one that we anticipate any changes on potentially is the at-risk.
And the at-risk.
Correct. So just that one. And it's because we've had staff changes and we'd like their input.
That makes sense. I just want to make sure that
it's clear.
We get some information on what either we support or change.
But they all have changes.
There are changes within each of those, correct. Except the activities and athletics.
Okay.
So that's part of the policy. Mm-hmm. Everyone changed because of electronic smoking devices.
Right.
Yep. So that language is added.
There. So there's a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion?
Just they were only posted today and I haven't looked at it.
No, it's fine.
That's not, yeah, that's my only one. We have a motion second, right?
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Item number seven, consideration and action on 2017-18 restraint and seclusion report. Lisa Chose will provide a summary of the 2017-18 restraint and seclusion report.
Can you start me? This is a report that I have to present to the school board annually, and it is the seclusion restraint report, and this is the number of seclusions and physical restraints we had in the district this previous school year. Altogether, there were 5 students who needed to be physically restrained or secluded, but there were 22 incidences of the actual restraining and the seclusion. I do have all the information in the report. I don't know if you want me to talk about it. But we currently have 52 staff members who are trained and certified in the nonviolent crisis intervention program. So all of the students who are restrained or secluded, what they followed the protocol for it, which includes the documentation. So I'm glad that they did fill out the documentation, and we'll continue to get staff members trained as the years go on, and we're hoping to get 100% of staff members trained in this. So all of the instances of physical restraint and seclusion were reported to parents that day as well, so it's documented that way that they get the information. So do you have any questions?
Very clear report.
Question. So 16 instances of physical restraint, seclusion for one student at the early learning center?
Right.
So is there a limit as to how many times and what can happen before, you know, a different action is taken? Or
so this, I mean, that's not the only action that was taken, I mean, for that particular student. We do talk, we do debrief after each of those instances. Jamie and the staff debriefed about what happened. And a physical restraint for a 4-year-old is very different than for a 15-year-old or whatever. So that particular student, we had constant meetings about and talked about different things we could do. But just know that there were other things that were done with the student, including lots of positive behavioral interventions and other types of consequences as well.
Things were severe enough that it could be an expulsion or a removal from the classroom situation?
Correct. And and the expulsion obviously didn't happen, but the removal sometimes did.
Yeah. It seemed like we talked about this a long time ago, but can you just refresh my memory? What would be an example of a restraint that you...
Sure. So there's restraints that we teach our teachers, and we have crisis teams at each of the buildings. And so we do a refresher with that team every year to talk about what appropriate restraints are. So the restraints are usually for, let's say, a 4-year-old, that's just usually a 1-person restraint, and there's a children's restraint hold that we teach our staff. For older students who are bigger than staff members, there's a 2-restraint hold. And it's just to get the immobilized, and we only use it when students are either a danger to themselves or others. Otherwise, we back away, we let them do whatever they need to do. So it really is used as a last resort in all. If you wanted me to send you, there's pictures, I can send you different pictures of what the restraints look like.
I was just hoping that you personally weren't going to have to restrain a boy bigger than yourself. So
I have before.
Oh, really?
Yeah, but it's a 2-person. High school is 2 people do it.
And usually at the high school and middle school level, Officer Kurt just walked in, and he's on his way. We're talking about seclusion and restraint, and it's generally basically to ensure the safety of that student and others around him or her.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Were there any further questions? So we need to take action on the restraint and seclusion report.
Do that we accept the report. I move that we accept the 2018 restraint seclusion report.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Item number eight, consideration and action on resolutions accepting resignations, if any.
And unfortunately, we do have a resignation in your packet. Jamie Licht has elected to move on, and that will be a loss to our school district. Jamie's served our school district very well and makes great connections with students, and we wish him the best as he moves to a different position in a different district.
So we need a motion to accept his resignation?
I will reluctantly make a motion to accept Jamie's resignation.
Second.
This is a resolution, so we'll take a roll call.
Kylie?
Yes.
Fred?
Yes.
Kathy?
Epstein.
Jeff?
Yes.
Dan?
Yes.
I'll vote yes. Mark?
Yes.
Sarah?
Yes.
John?
Yes.
Yes, one abstention.
Motion carries.
And I just want to also recognize Karen Cry. We don't necessarily take action, but Karen has elected to retire from our school district at the end of last school year, and will be greatly missed at our high school by the staff and students that she's worked with over the years. She's been a fixture at the front desk at high school for many years.
How long has she been here?
24, 28, 28.
She's a fixture.
Yes, 28 years at our high school, so.
We'll miss her, for sure.
We are going to miss Karen.
Item number nine, consideration and action on staff transfers for 2018-19.
And we do have some transfers. I apologize, they have, some of them have happened very recently, and you'll get notices. They're usually just the one-page summary, but we have a few transfers in our district. Recently, we had an opening at the fifth grade level. Terry Smith has requested to transfer to the fifth grade. When Terry was initially hired, she was a fifth grade teacher in our school district, and we recommend they transfer. Do we do these individually, or can we do them as a group? I think we can do them as a group. Okay. The departure of Terry at the first grade level created a domino effect, and Megan Quigley requested a transfer into the first grade position, and we're recommending that you approve Megan's transfer from fourth grade at River Valley Elementary to first grade at River Valley Elementary. When we hired Megan initially, she taught at the early grades. I think she taught a combo K-1, I believe, when she was initially hired, and then first grade in Lone Rock. And also, Joni Harrington has requested to transfer into Karen Cry's position at the high school. It's a 9-month position. That's really what she was looking for. It better meets her lifestyle, and Joni's also someone with 20 plus years of experience in our district, and we're looking forward to having her in her new role at our high school.
I would make a motion. Never mind, go ahead, sir.
Oh, no, you go ahead.
We have to make a motion.
And I would make a motion that the board accept these three transfers of Terry, Megan, and Joni.
So from Terry Smith from first to fifth, Megan Quigley from fourth to first, and Joni Herring to the high school.
To the high school.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any further discussion?
Maybe we'll get to this in hiring. That you're looking for fourth grade?
We now have a posting, and Carla and I had a conversation today. We've got applicants. We have a posting on WeCan, which is an educational site, and Carla's hoping to interview the 23rd of this month.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Item 10, consideration and action of hirings.
And in your packet, you'll have two hiring summaries. The first is Stephanie Ivey, and I'll let Darby talk a little bit about that process.
So Stephanie, we actually did a little bit differently this year. We are, for this hiring, we had a panel of myself, Lisa Chose, Megan Bunkman, and Mitch Heinemeier, and we had three candidates, and we got down to two candidates that we liked very well, and we ended up having a student panel, and those are all listed on the hiring summary as well, all the students in there. And it was, I'll probably never do another hiring without a student panel again for a staff member. It was really a great experience to see our students. And Stephanie came through with just flying colors, really interacted well with the students thought highly of her. And we took all that information from the students, met again with the original group, and decided to go with Stephanie. She comes to us from Ithaca. Strong reading background, tons of experience working with families and students at risk. And we're very excited. It's a tough, another tough position to find. And she also knows Leah Hansen, and there's a connection there. So I think they're going to be able to work together well as she kind of learns more about the position. Tom already mentioned the at-risk handbook. We're going to be going over that. It'll be a nice way to kind of let her know more about our program, which we call the Pathways Program at the high school for our at-risk students. We're just happy to have Stephanie on board and excited to have her start working with those students.
And then the, we do one at a time for this.
We do, okay.
Yeah, sorry.
Motion to accept.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.
And then the second hiring we're going to recommend is for a middle school special ed position, and we're going to recommend Courtney Norton, and Lisa and James led that interview. I think, Lisa, do you want to talk about that process?
Sure. We had six applicants and we interviewed five, I think. Some of them had teaching licenses, some of them didn't, but Courtney did come out on top. And so we're really excited. Courtney is, she has subbed in our district for many years, and she's our probably one of the favorite subs of our special ed team across the grade levels. And so I think she's going to transition pretty well. She's going to get her emergency license right away and get into the program there. But I think that she's excited, and we're excited to have her. She'll be a good fit at the middle school. And we're still looking for one more.
One more
middle school
special ed teacher in the middle school.
Correct. And just understand that the special ed world is in such dire need that we did offer a position to another candidate who just finished an undergrad program, has not an education, had zero experience, zero student teaching, and had three job offers on the table, and elected to go to another district. I mean, it is a unique world right now in our hiring process.
How long would it take?
Can I get a motion to
accept? Oh, motion to accept.
Accept the hiring of Courtney Norton?
Yes. Sorry.
So, motion back for a second. Any further discussion?
I just was interested to know, you got a degree, how long does it take to get a special ed licensure? Is it a year-long process?
Or? It's 2 years.
It's going to be 2 years, okay.
Any other discussion or questions? All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Item 11, consideration and action on resolutions accepting gifts.
And this is one of the most decent gifts that's come across this board since I've been in this chair. Tim Major, retired teacher in our school district, in the Alt-Ed program, after a brief conversation with Leah Hansen and also Lisa Chose, wrote us a check for $20,000. To help provide mental health services for students at the high school level. So I really want to acknowledge Tim. It's incredible. Huge cash donation. You basically, I think Lisa just said, use it as you need to, right?
And not just the high school.
Oh, the whole district? Okay. Which is just such a decent move. He's such a decent man.
That's amazing. What do you think you'll use it? How do you think you'll use it, Lisa?
Well, when he and I, we just communicated by email, I had written a message. district, and one of the things I wanted was to get a therapist in the district at least once a week to work with students who may not have insurance, who may not have, you know, go. So I think that will be the primary thing we do. And that is, like, all school districts are trying to get mental health in the schools, so it'll be a really good jumpstart.
That's great. That's impressive, $20,000.
Motion to accept.
Second, Mr. Hope.
It's a resolution, so we'll take a roll call.
Fred?
Yes.
Kathy?
Yes.
Jeff?
Yes.
Dan?
Yes.
Although yes, Mark?
Yes.
Sarah?
Yes.
John?
Yes.
Kylie?
Yes.
Nine yes.
Motion carries. Item number 12, consideration and action on school district appointment to the Spring Green Community Library Board.
Linda Kettner has served as the representative of the River Valley School District on the Spring Green Library Board for many years. I don't know exactly how many, but it's been a while. And with Linda's retirement, I was contacted by the library, and Linda and the librarian obviously had had a conversation ahead of time. And Linda would like to continue to represent the district on that board, and I see no reason not to continue that relationship.
I would make the motion to have Linda stay on as our rep.
Second, Sarah.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you, Linda.
Thanks, Linda.
Item number 13, consideration and action on technology committee recommendations.
We don't really have any recommendations, but there are a few updates. We did look at the Chromebooks that came in, a chance for Sean to take a good look at all of the devices. There were a few that he was still going through because of some late returns, because some of the teachers held on to the Chromebooks to the very last day. The district spent about $3,000 in repairs for the year. They are in very good repair. Our students are taking good care of them, especially considering Sean's conversations with other IT managers and other districts. He's very impressed. He does have some concerns as the devices age. There may be more repairs that are going to be coming down. We also had a replacement plan spreadsheet that's in the packet for the technology committee. Brian did work in some of the costs into our budget, so climbing forward. One thing to take note, there is a year where there's a gap in replacement of Chromebooks, and that falls very well with then the replacement of some of our iPads that are part of that program. We are bringing some from Arena, but all of those devices are aging out, and we're going to have to replace those. Let's see, there is a grant that will be available to help us offset an educational technology grant from the state. It provides $125 per student, but it is the number of ninth graders that are in the school as of May 28th of that year, and it's a reimbursement, so we will be getting some. We have to apply and hopefully get a check in, I think, December is what
probably
this.
Yeah.
So it's, I guess, not exactly what we had hoped for, but at least it's something about such costs.
So it's not $125 for everybody, it's $125 per ninth grader?
Per ninth grader.
Per ninth grader, correct. Enrolled in the district as of May 28th. This past May would be our check in. At least the way that it's being discussed, it's a four-year grant program. We'll see what future budgets do. That's it.
All right. Thank you, Fred. Item 14, consideration and action on policy committee recommendations. We have a long list that we'll go through. some policies that have been approved for first reading and recommending to the board for second reading. The first one is 185 rule, roles of board committee chairpersons and appointees. We're just updated to align with current practices. The board training advocacy position has been eliminated and added to the president's duties. Usually I'm not one for interruptions, but I'm going to go through these. If you have any questions, just go ahead and interrupt to ask. 411 rule, student non-discrimination complaint procedures. The student discrimination complaint procedure has been updated. We don't need to report discrimination complaints directly to the state superintendent of public instruction. We still have to report to the feds, but that's the updated in our policy now. 751.3 bus rules and regulations. Per the school nurse recommendations, eating on the bus is no longer allowed unless the bus trip is organized by a supervisor or a coach, such as a field trip or a sports event. Basically, because peanut allergies and to prevent anaphylactic reactions. Again, this was per the school nurse recommendations.
And that's because the buses, as we don't have the EpiPens.
Currently, they don't have the EpiPens. 444, school-age parents. The nursing staff updated the language in this policy to reflect our current practices. Instead of providing a school-age parent program for teens, the staff provides individual counseling, guidance, and planning for the education and health of school-age parents and provides collaboration and referrals to outside agencies. So this is just updated to reflect our current practices. 452.5, student physical examinations. The nursing staff updated this language to include information from the WIAA. The next policies all have been updated to reference our new policies on tobacco use and vaping to include that. So I'm just going to read the name of the policy, and if you read through it, you can see where it's been updated. Only thing that's been updated is for the tobacco and vaping. 752, district vehicle use, 830, use of school facilities, 830, rural facilities use regulations, 830, exhibit facilities use request form, 831, public conduct on school property, and 832, tobacco and electronic smoking devices possession and or use on school premises. So the policy committee is recommending these to the board for second reading. So if anyone would like to make a motion in that intent, that would be great.
So moved.
Thank you, Fred.
Thank you, Fred. Is there a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. We have several policies that we are recommending to the board for first reading. The first one, 345.4, academic honors and high school lottery system, 345.4, rule lottery system procedures, and 345.4, exhibit lottery chart. We had a biannual lottery review from the committee, and it was determined by this committee that the classes that offer lottery points would remain the same offerings moving forward, but it was decided to change the way the current formula is split there. We're going to alter the presentation of the chart and the setup of the current lottery system to be more easily understood by all. We're going to take the multiplication formula out and just have a chart that says if you have this grade point average and you have this many points, this is your honor. So the other thing that we decided is this new system would be for the class of 2022 moving forward, so that's the incoming freshmen. The rest of the people or the classes in high school are used to the existing system and have scheduled certain classes, and this is what they will graduate with. So it will sunset out in a couple of years. So right now our policy will have both of these in here. They'll have the existing quality system, and then we also include what it will be for the class of 2022 going forward. The other thing that we did is we removed the rule, I believe.
Yes.
Because it just was a duplicate of the policy. There was nothing in the rule that wasn't in the policy, so that's why we eliminated it. And if you look at the chart, it really just is a lot simpler. So are there any questions on that or further clarification from anyone on the policy committee?
I think it was also from the staff's recommendation to, one, to simplify it, but also that there were some students that were just missing hitting some lottery points, And then it potentially discouraged them from taking out some part of classes just to keep their GPA up. This way, it would still encourage some of these students to go for a higher level class and still get body points and get recognized.
And also with this new system, we're capturing a 3.0 grade point average where before it started at 3.2. And we're making the higher honors just a little bit higher to achieve. So there are just some slight changes to that.
Paula was working on the chart today, and it's much more easy to comprehend than the previous system. It'll be much easier for parent planning meetings and meetings that the counselors have with students.
I mean, when you talk to people and you say, you multiply this by this, and people would glaze over. So now you're just saying, match your grade.
You just slide across.
It's just,
GPA and body points.
It's essentially the same chart, it's just it's simpler.
And it was a strong recommendation by staff who've been working on this for many, many years. We first adopted it and have been working with this system and finding that this calculation is just, it's missing out potential for a few students to get recognition for hard work, and they wanted to recognize that.
There'll be 3 to 5 additional students a year per class, they estimate.
Right.
That will be recognized, but why not? That's a good one.
141 board officers. The duties of the president have been expanded to include promoting board training and development opportunities because the board training advocacy position has been eliminated. 185 board committees and appointments. We combined the ERC and the budget committee and we eliminated the board training advocacy position, so this policy now reflects that. 225 rule district administrator evaluation. We are recommending to evaluate the district administrator once a year instead of twice for the purpose of being able to address possible problems, concerns before the end of the year. The evaluation is proposed to take place at the December board meeting. So with that, those are the recommendations that we have to the board for first reading.
Kathy, I think it's worth also mentioning the reason why we moved that date was because with the contract renewals, that would have to be the decision would have to be made in January. So we wanted to give the board enough time to give a month advance notice before we then take on the renewal. So it's just so that we're all kind of on the same page. And,
so I would entertain a motion to accept for first reading 345.4, the Laude system, 345.4, the rule, 141 board officers, and 185 board committees and appointments, 225 administrator evaluation procedure for first reading. Does anybody want to make that motion? Jim, is there a second? Kylie, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you. Item 15, consideration and action on budget ERC committee recommendations.
We had a meeting on Monday. We discussed a proposal from Scott Moore for lighting the soccer field, and we tabled it until the next ERC budget meeting. We're going to have Brian do some work on the forecast 5 budget assumptions and projections before we commit to spending the extra money. There's a couple different proposals, one of which had no cost and one of which had a small district contribution. We talked about the forecast 5 budget assumptions and projections, along with how that would affect any number for the referendum, and we came up with some ideas. Brian and John are going to work on updating those projections. And we're going to talk about them at the next 2 budget meetings. We'll have 2 of them before we come back to the full board in August, because I think at the August meeting we have to have a number and write the question. So we'd like to be prepared for that. We talked about vacation in the employee handbook, and basically we recommended some changes to the vacation language. Just for clarification, no structural changes. That was the only employee handbook recommendation that we had. And I believe that those changes, Paul, that you had put in the employee handbook that we just approved.
Correct.
So I don't know if we need to take that recommendation and approve it again, it's been already been approved back to the handbook. And we discussed the 2019-20 and 2020-21 school calendars. We do not currently have Martin Luther King Junior Day as a day off from school, so we discussed whether we wanted to implement that or not. And administration was going to have another discussion at their weekly meeting. I don't know if you want to discuss that now, decide, or if you want to go back to budget.
It was kind of mixed. I mean, administratively, I think we didn't come to resolution, but we kind of talked about the two issues. Is it more respectful and more of an honor if you have that day off of school? And we're not talking about the next school year, we're talking about the next 2 years' calendar cycle, so 2020-21 school years. Or is it a better opportunity to provide some diversity and multicultural instruction to our students if they're in school that day? We're a very non-diverse school district. We talked about, you know, trying to potentially maybe do an exchange program at the middle school level with a more diverse middle school, potentially in the Madison area, those kinds of activities. So we didn't reach resolution either, so it's going to be a continuing conversation for us.
Okay. Other than that, we've decided to meet the second and fourth Mondays of the month. So we should have two meetings with our committee before each board meeting, so we will get more accomplished.
Okay, thank you, John. Item 16, consideration and action on school forest, buildings and grounds committee.
Thank you, Madam President. We had a meeting last night. It was well attended. We had a lengthy discussion on the process going forward for the sale of the Lone Rock and Arena schools. Mr. Novak had advised us to not have an appraisal value of the buildings because of some potential problems that, you know, could occur because of that. Mr. Wormuth advised us that there are approximately 6 or 7 different people interested in the Lone Rock building. One additional interest in the arena building, that's a private interest. Much discussion was had as to whether or not the Village of Lone Rock is interested or not. The committee would like to engage with the Lone Rock Village Board to clarify whether or not they are interested in moving forward with the purchase of the building. So that's it's a significant issue, a touchy issue, but we're still on track for possibly October. We may have to postpone that a little bit, depending on the groups that are interested and whether or not funding is in place. But we'd still like to move forward and get these buildings occupied, especially Lone Rock. It's been vacant now for over a year. So, the committee asked Mr. Wormuth to contact school's council and verify whatever legal aspects might be involved with the bid process. So, kind of ironing that out.
Deed restrictions, those types of things.
Right. We talked about school safety. That's something that's on our agenda every meeting. And both Mr. Wormuth and Mr. Novak advised the committee on a statewide school safety grant program. He already alluded to that at the beginning of the meeting, so I don't have to talk about the status of that. There was emphasis on the primary focus, secondary focus of what that money could be used for, and I was told that lock safety in entrance areas is a primary focus.
Correct.
Whereas a secondary focus would be planning and training, exit strategies, evacuation strategies, and stuff like that. Mr. Wormuth also mentioned curriculum programs that are you know, kind of headed up by our pupil services department, having to do with engaging students and staff in discussions about school safety and threat and stuff like that, so.
And relationship building, it's really more of a, you know, relationship building curriculum.
Right. We've already talked about the new playground equipment, so September is our goal for the new playground equipment. Takes about a week to install. Mr. Ferguson gave us a report on Dasher, on the summer work, it's progressing, although he seemed awful tired to me. We lost a custodian, but he is in the process of interviewing right now. OSHA training is complete for July. We talked a little bit about phase one of the two-year energy exemption projects, and apparently those are proceeding. We were told last night that asbestos tile was found under the carpeting in room 24. So that's just an ongoing problem. It's not a hazard. Asbestos is not a hazard unless it's disturbed, so we'll have to deal with that. There was just a real short discussion on the status of the school forest in our district, and we continue to talk about that slow evolution, and our next meeting is at September 17th.
If not sooner.
If not, yes, and we will probably have to meet before September if the bid process starts to gain some steam.
Thank you, Mark. Item 17, consideration and action to adjourn to closed session pursuant to Wisconsin Statutes 19.851C for discussion of district administrator end-of-year evaluation and discussion of administrator end-of-year evaluations. Entertain a motion. We need a motion to go into closed session.
I make a motion to go into closed session. And we should let Carla know that the meetings always get done about 8 o'clock.
Right.